Yes, thank you for this introduction. My name is Jochen Köhler. I had the pleasure to lead this working group 4 on the case studies together with Helmut Wenzel. So this working group was working or was starting working more or less in the midterm of this cost action, and the aim and objective of this working group was to demonstrate the benefits and the feasibility of value of information analysis in structural engineering decision making. Also, this working group, I believe, was the platform for a very intensive information interchange. So many researchers from all over Europe did actually try to implement the principles of Bayesian decision theory and in particular value of information analysis in the practical projects they do anyway. So I think there was a very steep learning curve among the participants. And also in working group 4, maybe this was this working group where the participants took the most benefit from the state, from the training schools we organized within this cost action. Also now, and this is still ongoing after this final conference, we try to use this case studies to demonstrate the feasibility and the potential of these methodologies to relevant stakeholders from industry. And I think with some of the case studies, we rather reached a level where this objective can be fulfilled. So we called for case studies in early 2016. That was at the time where working group 1, 2, 3 already established their principles and the material we could take benefit from. And then a large number of teams, actually I don't mention the exact number because it was a lot of teams responded. That was very nice and initiated working on case studies. At least they did come up with a proposal how a case study could look like. And then we did try to set this analysis into practice. And as it was the objective, we wanted to demonstrate not only the benefits and the feasibility of case studies, but we also did find some obstacles and some problems when it comes to the practical implementation. This was already discussed before the break. So before the break, we saw all this beautiful theory, this very consistent and nice formulas, how the principles work. When you really go into a field and look at the real structure, as you all know, we realize that the one-to-one implementation of these principles is not so easy. So the perspective we had to take in these case studies was not from the bottom up, where we look at the theory and then we try to put some practical values on these different corners of the theoretical concept and try to pull it through from the bottom up. I think a very useful perspective for implementing the case studies was also to come from top down, to look at the decisions themselves, to look how these decisions are made in practice. And these decisions that are made in practice, they have principal properties. And the first and very obvious property, but this has to be mentioned because it's important to start with, is that these decisions, they are done, right? So they are made, irrespectively whether we have a beautiful theory of value of information or not. So decisions, for instance, in regard to the continuous maintenance and development of the infrastructure, they are just made. And now the perspective that is useful when we want to implement the theory in case studies is that we want to make these decisions better by helping with our principles and this framework of posterior decision analysis and also of a pre-posterior decision analysis. So it's not to get to full theory and try to implement it into practice. I think for case studies it was a very useful perspective to look The decisions are already somehow made, and they have to be made continuously in the future. And we have to look how can we formulate the decisions in a way that they are made better than not considering these theoretical principles. So we have these individual terms, teams that have been working on these case studies, and the onset of work was producing fact sheets where the case studies had been described. And then the further development of these case studies was then supported by workshops and, as I mentioned, by these training schools. This worked quite well. And I think we can say that we have reached a big number of case studies that have been far developed and reached a status where they disseminate their results. It's 13 case studies, which is a number I would not have believed that this would be reachable when we started with the work. I think this is a very big accomplishment. So not all of these case studies are documented in a fact sheet, but very importantly, all of them had been documented at least in one conference contribution. Some of them have more than one, and we reached also already a rather high number of journal publications that document these case studies. So I think that is a very good way to disseminate the results and also to promote these concepts. And as I said, these case studies, they take all a starting point in a practical application. More journal publications are planned. So we are planning to set up a special issue in engineering structures. Their rough estimate is that we might reach 12 journal publications. And we also wrote a summary paper that will be presented in Gumaraj in March at the JAPSE conference, where we summarized the insights and lessons learned from the case study portfolio. So now I will take some few minutes to present you some examples of the case studies. So these case studies go into different areas in our built environment, and they also reach different levels of detail, and they come from different groups that had been participating in the case study. So it will be 5 examples, but all the examples or all the case studies will be documented in the PowerPoint slides after my last official slide. So you can, when you download the slides after the conference from the webpage, you can get a brief overview about all case studies by having these slides. So the first was chosen as the first one because it was really the first case study that was pulled through by Dimitris Diamantidis and Miroslav Sukova. It was about the monitoring of snow on the roof. It's a rather obvious example, and interestingly, it's also very actual again because there was a lot of snow again in the Alps. It was a very extreme snow event, and then of course, when you have such extreme snow events and you have a structure at risk, then you ask yourself, how much should I invest to monitor the snow on the roof? So this was considered here. As you see in the table, there had been 3 different alternatives for measuring or for indicating the snow load on the roof. The first was the snow depth on the ground on a nearby meteorological station. So this is the most crude information that was considered. Then you can be a little bit more specific and you measure the snow depth on the roof. Or as an option, S3, you can also estimate the snow load on the roof, which is then even a less uncertain indicator for the load that the structure is exposed to. And the costs had been considered, and it was found that investing into the direct measurement is the most efficient one. So this has been documented and disseminated in two journal public or in two journal public no in one journal publication and two conference publications. So one is in the conference on ICASP on the international conference on the application of statistics and probability in South Korea. So that's very nice. Something like this is disseminated. So the second example I have is also a very early example, and that's also nice because it's implemented on a very well-known bridge in Stockholm, Steel Bridge. And there, the problem was that there was some fatigue, and this fatigue did cause a crack in a structural part of the construction, and this crack propagation was monitored. And as you can see, some Bayesian network was used to represent the system, and some rather progressive assumptions had been made, of course, of pulls in order to pull this example through. But I think this case study also very nicely did demonstrate the principle and the logic of the relationship between the information and the content of this information for doing decisions quite well. And as the other case study, this did also lead to quite a number of publications. So here, when the review will finally be successful, then we have three journal publications coming from this case study. The next example is from a bridge again. It is a concrete bridge, and here the monitoring was on the response of the bridge due to traffic load in order to learn about the real traffic load on the bridge. As you all know, the traffic loads that we have in our structural codes, they are quite conservative, meaning that they include a bias on the safe side. And when it comes to a decision of a lifetime extension of a bridge, it's maybe a good idea to look at the real load this bridge is exposed to in order to make an informed decision about the further reliable utilization of the bridge. This was done in this example, and a positive effect of this weight in motion measurements that had been analyzed here had been found. It's also, it should be mentioned that this project was a nice collaboration within the cost framework. It was actually a collaboration between Zagreb, between University of Zagreb and DTU in Denmark. Also short-term scientific missions had take place for this. So this is a very good example how the different tools we have available in the cost action did lead to a nice result. Also here we have a few publications as a result. So here we have an example from a different domain. Here we look at a wind energy converter that is placed offshore. And the problem here was that in the design phase, so before the wind converter is built, we want to design the foundation, and we want to design the structure of the wind turbine, and we have to take into account the dynamic response of the converter, and this depends on the stiffness of the structure itself, but also very much on the stiffness of the soil. So in order to be in the right version, in the right region, to have not so a critical fatigue behavior, we have to know something about the stiffness of the soil. And in this example, we looked at possible soil tests in order to update our information about the soil stiffness and to justify the costs of such tests. Here we had also to make some critical assumptions to pull this example through. in particular our assumption about the likelihood how the measurements of the soil relate to the true stiffness had been somehow roughly assumed. But we demonstrated the applicability of this concept, and we did come to some interesting conclusions. We had some two conference publications so far. If we have this special issue, we also consider to have a journal publication on that. Maybe also working a little bit further on this likelihood modeling, representation of the likelihood for the soil measurements. And then the last example, which was also a good collaboration between different partners in the COST network, facilitated by a short-term scientific mission. Here we are talking about a framework for the reassessment of timber structures. And as we already have, or as we already presume, there's maybe a benefit when we increase the level of detail of our reassessment of the structure in a sequential manner. So first start with a rough assessment and then increasing the level of detail, whether depending on the result of the more rough assessments. So in this case study, we or the colleagues did show that this is actually a very cost efficient way to do. So this was a very interesting example from the area of reassessment of timber structures, which did also lead to some publications. As before, it was two JAPSE symposia that did serve as a disseminator for this case study, but also I got positive indications that authors are also interested in a journal publication. So some lessons learned, as we already discussed in the morning, about the big challenges to apply a value of information analysis. From the case studies, maybe the most obvious obstacles had been the formulation of the prior uncertainty we have. So I think in engineering, in practical engineering, we have a culture to not consider uncertainties explicitly, but implicitly by conservative assumptions. And I think when it comes to strict value of information analysis, then this culture of being conservative and being biased in a way is setting a very a big challenge to the analysis. So making really a fair assessment of our large uncertainties we have in the absence of any additional measurements is of course very critical in order to prove that the measurements become cost effective. So this is a very critical aspect. Also, as discussed before, the formulation of the likelihood. So how do we link our observations to our property of interest? This is challenging, not only from a principal point of view that we hardly have so many measurements from the observation and the property of interest simultaneously that we can somehow empirically assess this likelihood. A big challenge is also associated due to the fact that we very often measure locally but are interested in more global responses, so that we have some problems on a spatial scale. Also, we have issues over time. But I think it's important to move on and to consider value of information analysis as a relevant tool for practical engineering. I think it's necessary to consider this always in relation to probabilistic assessment of a structure. So this is logical. It's the first step of refinement of our analysis we have to do in order to make a value of information analysis feasible. So we have to depart from the partial factor design format, what is of course our usual way to do analysis, to a probabilistic analysis. And I think this was very nicely demonstrated by the picture, if you remember, shown by Michael Faber today. He showed the picture where we have a lot of experience in the x-axis, so from a lot of experience and not so much experience, and then we have the consequences on the other axis. You remember this picture. And then, of course, the probabilistic analysis is very relevant for areas where we don't have so much experience, and the consequences are high. But that's, of course, very interesting, because when you consider an existing structure as something unique, then we also have to appreciate that very often we don't have so much experience about this particular structure. So I think for the assessment of existing structures, very much in general, not so much related or also related to volume of information analysis, but independent of that, I think when we talk about existing structures, it's very hard to calibrate a partial factor design format that is general enough to cover all different examples of existing structures in an accurate manner. So I think for existing structures, reliability methods, risk-based methods are a very good idea to utilize, especially when the stakes are high, when the consequences are high. And then the step to do a full Bayesian decision analysis, including pre-posteriori decision analysis, including volume of information, this step is actually not so big. So I think in order to tackle all these challenges we get with our aging infrastructure in the future, we anyway have to move on to probabilistic methods when it comes to existing structures. We have some further activity, as mentioned, or we will document all the case studies on our web page. We already have a very nice template for that, produced by Maria Pina. So she will talk about that a little bit later. We plan a special issue with approximately 12 contributions. We will have Helder later on. He will talk about that. And we will have an industry innovation event, or several of them, and also Helder will talk in his presentation about that. So I think for all these further activities, the case studies, they play an important role. And I think, to conclude, it was very good to have this working package in order to set a counterweight from the practical side to this beautiful theory. But we did actually accomplish to demonstrate that this principle and this way of thinking that's coming from the theory is very helpful also for practical applications. So there, I want to thank all the working group 4 participants. So there was a lot of work hours invested in this working group, so that was very good. And I also thank you for your attention. And I want to introduce Helmut Wenzel. He will also have a small presentation, 5 slides, he told me, where he will present something from his perspective, because he's really a practical engineer working with this concept, with these concepts every day. So thank you, Helmut. Yeah. And then I suggest a discussion round we can do after Helmut's presentation.
Thank you. Other way around.
Front back.
So, actually, nobody has to convince me of the value of information. You know, if you're an insider, value of information, that's clear. And if we look at our situation that you know, all these big companies are selling our data, then we know that this value of information might be billions. But how about our community? So some remarks from practice. Doesn't do anything. So some facts in practical work. So when we do some practical work, what we have to do is we have to explain our approaches and results to asset owners. And you know, most of the asset owners are either economists or lawyers. So this is very difficult. Another fact is that civil engineering is 99% deterministic, maybe more. And the civil engineers are very conservative, very difficult to convince. Even my engineers, you know, are always reluctant to use these wonderful tools. Another big issue which we face in practice is that when we get data and have data about our projects, if they are 50% complete, we are happy. That's a lot. But how can you do good statistics with 50% of the data? And the quality of data is not always what really helps us. There is not enough determination towards making good data. The consequence is, first of all, we have to find a way to communicate the value of information to our owners. And this is very difficult. And we have to simplify the approaches. You know, what has been presented here is wonderful. It is super fantastic on the scientific level. When we come out to practice, we will have to go down to a level, first of all, where we are understood, and secondly, that the owners are able to buy it, because it costs money. So, and another thing is, we have to deal with these unknown unknowns. There are a lot of things which we don't know. I give you a short example. I cannot tell you which one and where it is. I shouldn't show it, but in the offshore business, there are very complicated structures. This is one of the construction of one of the platforms in the North Sea, and the model that was telling us the expected lifetime of this structure contains about 200 parameters. So I'm sure if we know 200 parameters, I'm sure that we don't know another 20 of them which are relevant. So how to deal with that? This shows the result of people were unhappy with the performance of the platform. This shows the results of a diving campaign, that there was a big discrepancy between design and execution. And what you see here is that the piles are not centralized as they should be, and they were not fixed on the bottom. Just no details, but if you look at our monitoring system here, I think, what is the uncertainty? You know, this jacket is swaying with about a period of 10 seconds, and the diver has to have four measurements around the circle of the piles, and always with this swaying thing. Who tells us which kind of uncertainty we should put into our calculation? So what came out of this? You know, the fact was there were four parties engaged in assessing what does this mean to the structure, what is the expected lifetime. The original designer said 350 years is the lifetime, but considering that there were no mistakes made, the construction company, which made some overdesign just to help them during erection, calculated 806 years of lifetime of this structure. Then came a very famous consultant from Denmark that told us that the lifetime is 0.2 years, which is a little bit ridiculous because this came 2 years after the structure was found to be not really consistent. And the reasonable consultant from Austria said we have 52 years. So how to deal with this? I came finally in and to make a kind of assessment of all this information. I collected more than the other people had. And then we applied some very simple things. This is a Monte Carlo simulation on, this is a sliding surface. We see here, I don't see a sliding surface. And there's a water level, and this could push one of the piles, for example. And it contains very simple parameters, not too many. And here we have our uncertainties. So I very much like the work of the Joint Committee of Structural Safety. In their documents, you find a lot of interesting values for that. But when I put this to my guys, they say, well, this is very difficult to understand. So if you could make, let's say, a list of default values for uncertainties to be used, steel, concrete, all these kind of things, this would be helpful. We started with simulating with one standard deviation, and finally, using two models, came to a very simple representation. This is a factor of safety. This is understood. Even so, it is not what it is, but this is what you can sell. And also, in nice and important would be this the coloring, because you can show them, if they tell them the factor of safety is one, okay. But if they say you're more to the green than to the red, the economists are happy. So what we have to do is simplify it, but not give us, let's say, two simple things where we predict then with, accuracy of plus minus 30%. In the cost action 1406, which is also in relation, I think most of you know that we have collaborated, there were models elaborated to how to represent this. And this is a spider, you know, in 1406 we use a five-leg spider. Okay, doesn't make much difference, but when we use this, we get a clear allocation of the phenomena. For example, safety, we use the Eurocodes, 1990 series, for safety and durability. For serviceability, we use the sector-specific rules. And this is new here, economy, environment, and safety. It's not new, of course, but it helps me to convince economists and the lawyers that they should do this. And if we put the parameters, which we now specify in this ISO 21292, tomorrow I will have the final meeting on this, and this will be published soon, then we can bring our things also successfully through the process of accepting it. This is how it works, and we have done such a spider diagram, and finally we can say the smaller the area below here, the bigger the risk. And as a last slide, I just wanted to show that one of the, this is from the IRIS project quite some time ago, but these results are already standardized. This is a new Eurocode 16991, was standardized last year in May, and it contains our aging model. There's a mathematical formulation of aging. To use this makes now sense, because if we make an assessment right now, people ask us, so what after 10 years? This model can say, according to most probable degradation, in 10 years your rating will be such and such. So that's it. Thank you very much for listening.
So this is some time for questions. Are there any questions from the audience? Yeah, Dimitris.
Okay. Thank you very much. It was very interesting to see how it goes from the theory to practice, especially moving to standardization. Jochen, do you have some results which changed due to the fact of working at four different levels of detail in the timber structure example? So was the first level of detail, which was approximate, did show other results compared to the last? Do you have a sensitivity study with that? Or because I have not studied the whole example, therefore I'm asking, I find it very interesting, especially with respect to assessment of existing structures. Yes.
Yeah, there I would like to lead over to the author, the main author of this study.
Who is that? You are the main author. Okay.
So basically what we've done, it was an actual case study. We've done all of these assessment methods. And what we analyzed, me and Daniel, was successive or a successive assessment or non-successive assessment worthwhile? What shall we do? So when we applied it, we noticed that if we go more into detail in the beginning, we can save money in this sense. I don't know what was the actual question, sorry.
The actual question is the level of detail plays an important role, and I know for timber structure it's already somehow standardized, and it is standardized in Germany for the reassessment of bridges. We have several levels of details. We can go up to reliability-based assessment. Therefore, I asked just to promote this. I like this example, and therefore I try to take this to promote it further. And I would like to add something here to Helmut. Helmut, in the Joint Committee, we have a report on a probabilistic assessment of existing structures with a very good example how the central safety factor for the foundation has changed based on new data on wave loading for an offshore platform and new measurements of the soil. So it's similar to what you presented with an updating. Just to add on that, thank you.
Well, I'm aware of all these works. These are the wonderful words. But in practice, you know, the engineers, they don't have enough time. You know, they are all pushed, you know, you have to deliver your result tomorrow. So how can they read all these documents? You know, I have a big folder of all your publications and I like the work very much. But to have a standard catalog of standard deviations, for example, would be helpful.
Yes. Thank you very much for these points, Helmut. But we have educational activities from the JCSS. We have documented, not the JCSS, has documented as studies where to go for probabilistic assessment and what the value actually, the cost saving is. So I would also ask the question, or I would point to the direction of education of engineers first, and second, rigorous management to do the best analysis for the cases we have seen. For the cases where it is really sensible.
Well, so I think it's the responsibility of the engineer to point to that it's necessary to make a more detailed analysis.
Yes,
that's a cultural problem.
This is no problem. No question. But you know, education is a disaster, or it is not non-existent. This is one of the major things we find. Mm-hmm. All the engineers I have, this is about 300, have never heard anything about it. Really? So is there something to do?
No question.
You have to give us also some, let's say, more hands-on tools. JCSS is excellent top-level science, and you know the small engineers are afraid of it.
Okay. The first hand was by Jörg, please.
I have a short question. I thought what you said, this calibration of the unknowns of unknowns, I think this is very important for like real structures. So my question is, like if you do the theory, it's all based on some model assumptions, say be it the numerical model or be it like the stochastic model. From your experience, when I look at the example where you said the lifetime is 0.2 years or it's 50 or is it 50 something, so like the results really diverge on based on the assumptions that you're making or based on the data. From your point of view, what is the important, in practical applications, what is the important, like, based on these assumptions, the range of results that you're getting? And so is it really important to do a probabilistic analysis and focus on more going into the methods itself or better understand what the unknowns of unknowns that you were talking about is? So kind of understanding what is the model inaccuracies, either the numerical model in terms of, say, finite element or the probabilistic model?
Well, in this specific case, you know, the big difference comes from modeling, of course. This is how do you construct your model? What are your assumptions? This is no question. This unknown unknowns is just giving you an additional corridor of possible results that you say, for example, I have a structure offshore where I cannot maintain or where I cannot go every time, so I have to be more safe. So within the corridor, I have to design it, over-design it. This is where we use that. And you know what we've done here is very brutal. It's a Monte Carlo simulation, and we put another factor, and the factor has a variation of 10%. And then you just widen your corridor for possible results. This is what you can do, and this is very, very well accepted because you can show this. How does it work straightforward? And how do you, if you say we don't know everything, okay, we make a wider corridor of results. This is what we do in practice. And this is, does not match, let's say, all the sophistication that we have heard here.
Any more questions, Dimitris?
Well, it was very, very general because Helmut said the education, this is the main problem. I pointed that out also in Lisbon, the education of young engineers. I am representative of the alumni of civil engineering in my university. I'm in contact of 4,000 or 5,000 of them, but they cannot use the methods which I teach. So the problem, it has to start at a low level, as Johan is doing, for example, at the bachelor degree. Mm-hmm. So it's not only the master degree we have selected. And if you see the courses of the Joint Committee, they are attended mainly by PhD students. So this is not only the level we aim to reach, at least long term.
I fully agree. You don't have to convince the PhDs. This is no question. You have to start with basic education.
Okay, I think for the moment we will conclude this, the discussion. Thank you very much for your presentations and insights.